the Soviet Union and China, two nations which were at least for a stint of time seen as close allies. And indeed, the Soviets were de facto allies to the Chinese during the Second World War, and for years into the Cold War. Yet, as is usual with history, things aren't as clean and clear as are generally portrayed, and the two would fight one another in a multitude of conflicts that are rarely discussed in the retelling of history. While minor border skirmishes are common and easy to ignore, there was no mere small skirmish, and instead would see the largest deployment of the Red Army until the Soviet entry into the Second World War. It is July of 1929, and war has begun. The Sino-Soviet conflict stemmed from ownership disputes on who owned the Chinese Eastern Railway, a railway that directly connected the major cities of Vladivostok, Seoul, Pyongyang, Harbin, and Beijing, which was the only railway that connected China to their northern provinces. The Russians and later Soviets had great interest in the line as it provided a significantly shortened route to and from Vladivostok. The Russians had occupied northern Manchuria during the 1894 Sino-Japanese War and were granted the rights to build the Eastern Railway by the Jin government. In 1898, construction of a 550-mile spur line began at Harbin, leading southward through eastern Manchuria along the Liaodong Peninsula to the ice-free port at Lushun, which the Russians were fortifying and developing into a first-class naval base and marine coastal station for its far eastern fleet. While construction on this line would be completed by 1903, the Russo-Japanese War would see the line at Lushun, as well as the majority of the Southern Korean line, fall directly under Japanese control. On July the 25th of 1919, the Soviet's Assistant Commissioner of Foreign Affairs, Lev Karakin, had issued a manifesto to the Chinese government, promising them the return of the Eastern Railway to their control at no cost to the government. It would take some years before the two governments met for a greater discussion of the railway control, and a secret protocol would be signed on March the 14th of 1924. The protocol stated that all previous agreements, treaties, and commissions between the Chinese and the former Russian Empire were to be annulled, and a joint commission will later revisit and revise all of them. In regards to the railway, though, a major obstacle stood in the way of Soviet-Chinese management of the line, and that was Jean Chulian, the warlord that had control over the Mukden government, and thus the majority of the northern Manchurian land. With this complication, the Soviets pushed their secret protocol on the central government, while striking a deal with Chulian himself. They promised him full control of choosing which Chinese officials would be on the joint board of the CER, and granted him just shy of half of the total control of the railway as well. Here, the Soviets managed to spring their trap, as while Chulian would have control over the Chinese officials appointed, the secret protocol signed earlier with the Chinese government gave the Soviets nearly total control over appointments, meaning that the majority of the board would be manned by Soviet officials. This foreign management would continue on for a number of years until 1929, when Chinese authorities stormed the Soviet consulate in Harbin, arresting the general manager of the CER, his assistant, and other Soviet citizens. The Soviets were to retaliate by arresting Chinese citizens within the USSR and cutting off diplomatic relations with the Chinese. Calls for war came from many members in the Soviet cabinet, and on August the 6th, Joseph Stalin would create the Special Red Banner Far Eastern Army, commanded by Valsi Blücher. Nearly 20% of all Soviet armed forces would be mustered into this army, numbering a total of 110 men, and this would be the largest use of Soviet troops since the Civil War until their entry into World War II. Jean, getting intel of the gathering Soviet forces, quickly raised his own army, gathering well over 200,000 men in a combination of veterans, standing regulars, policemen, and local militia. At its core would be 3,000 white Russian emigrants that had migrated to northern Manchuria years previously. And this, along with his personal guard units, would act as the hardened core of the Manchurian army. The first major action would take place at Chalinar on August the 18th. The Chinese quickly retreated from the town, but as the Soviets advanced further, they were faced with deep entrenchment lines, supported by machine guns. An attempt to push them out failed, and while the Soviets would keep a hold of the city, it would cost them 200 casualties. Skirmishes would continue for a number of months along the border, with small towns and villages trading hands back and forth as both forces mustered to their full strength. And it wouldn't be until October when the next major move would take place. Blücher had developed a plan of attack that centered around rapid envelopment and preventing any escape should a siege take place. Firstly, his aim was to destroy the Chinese naval forces in the area, massively slowing down the resupply and reinforcement of the forward units. With control of the waterways, he hoped to be able to transport his own army around the Chinese in Manchuria and swallow their armies up in whole. Or, if that couldn't be accomplished, then have his men march south, taking Yamsui, then head towards Harbin. Putting his plan into motion, the Amur Flotilla, which consisted of four relatively modern Typhoon-class river monitors and smaller craft, would engage the main Chinese fleet at the Battle of Lashui. The Soviet victory here allowed them to land troops and capture the city of Tonian. With the loss of the city, Chinese forces retreated back to Yamsui and dug in for the next attack. Off to the west, Soviet forces would clear the border town of Manchui on November the 18th and quickly occupy up to the Buri Lake. But before further action could take place, the two sides managed to come to the table and negotiated a peace settlement. In the Khabarovsk Protocol, signed on December the 13th, the terms simply stated that the parties were to return to the status quo of the 1924 agreement over the railway, effectively giving Soviets majority control again, and any territory occupied was to be returned to the original owners. The conflict would leave Manchuria in a power vacuum, and the Japanese, long since eyeing to face their centuries-long continental rival, wouldn't let this opportunity to slip past them, but that is a topic for another time.